Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Recently, I started my work on the online martial arts teaching program since the current lockdown may be eased soon. I'd like to ask you all a favor. In order to create a better learning experience, I need some data from you. If you are interested in sharing your opinions and preferences with me toward this goal, please fill out the survey linked in the description. There are only a few questions and the whole process only take you about a couple of minutes to complete. I would appreciate it if you spend some time to answer these questions for me. Thank you in advance. Also, next week's video will be the monthly Q&A. So please post your questions in the comments or email me if you prefer to be anonymous. So today's video focuses on an aspect of methodology in martial art training. I have talked about methodology in a prior video titled Old Master's Path, Internal Style Concepts 9. In that video, I introduced a basic framework of martial training methodology. I also talked about the term Lao Tou Quan or Old Man Form in that video. Today, I will talk about another important topic related to methodology. By the way, I recommend you watch that video before watching this one. Link is in the description. The information in today's video is a bit advanced since it introduces some abstract concepts. Regardless, please keep watching. I believe that topics introduced in this video will help you understand the traditional way of practice on a much deeper level. You will realize the value of the content in this video with time. Also, I believe this content will be very beneficial to future generations as well. Keep in mind, to reach a high level in any practice, you absolutely need to understand key concepts to make tangible progress. Without the correct theoretical foundation, mere physical practice would not take you too far. So, topics covered in today's video include: first, Wang Duo and his calligraphy; second, Shi Gu and its standard; third, Chinese aesthetic standard of physical movement; fourth, Ming and Qing dynasty documents on martial theory; fifth, traditional references for martial postures and body movements; 6. Common mistakes; 7. Demonstration; 8. Takeaways. So, let's get started. Topic 1. Wang Duo and his calligraphy. First things first, who was Wang Duo? Well, if you take an active interest in Chinese calligraphy, you must have heard his name. Wang Duo was a calligrapher, painter, and a poet who lived between the year 1592 to 1652 during the Ming Dynasty. Even today, he is considered as one of the best calligraphers in Chinese history. As a renowned scholar official in the late Ming and early Qing dynasties, he transformed traditional calligraphy styles into personal idioms of individual expression. His primary models in calligraphy study were the works of Wang Xizhi, who lived from 303 CE to 361 CE, who is considered as the most influential calligrapher in Chinese history. Through persistent practice, Wang Duo transformed the classical elegance of the style created by Wang Xizhi in the 4th century into his own inventive artistic language. many people collectively refer to these two people as 先王、后王 or early 王 and later 王 since both of them had the same family name and both achieved an extremely high level of skills in calligraphy, but they existed approximately 1,000 years apart. You can also refer to Wang Xizhi and Wang Duo as the Wang Duo. I'm a Chinese-Canadian dad, and that was a Chinese-Canadian dad joke. Anyway, his calligraphy is so great that many experts believe that his calligraphy is the best in the last 500 years. This is Wang Xizhi's work. And this is Wang Duo's work. By the way, I can confidently say that throughout Chinese history, almost every calligrapher artist has had to copy or at least draw inspiration from Wang Xizhi's work. His works of the earlier Wang. However, it does not mean that everyone can become a great calligrapher by merely copying his work. The reason is very simple. If you only copy Wang Xizhi's work without adding your own personal expression, then at the most, you would end up becoming a calligraphy copy machine. But on the other hand, if you do not copy his work, then you will never become a good calligrapher. Strange, but true. Before Wang Duo, the later Wang, passed away, he told his family members to find some good artist and carve his works on stone tablets, in case his family members were struck by poverty later on, they could copy the characters carved on the stone tablets and sell them. By the way, I have introduced the method that Chinese people have used to preserve their work throughout history by carving them on stone tablets, and also the method to copy these carved characters onto paper in one of my videos. Anyway, after Wang Duo passed away, his family member followed his advice and created more than 90 stone tablets based on his works. Fortunately, owing to the effort of many art collectors, his works, including the original manuscripts as well as the stone tablets, still exist today. These are some of the photos of these stone tablets. So, why am I talking about Wang Duo and his calligraphy? What does it have to do with the martial art? Well, the reason is very simple. There is a famous quote attributed to Wang Duo, which was originally about calligraphy practice, but can be applied perfectly in martial art training. The quote is, "Shu bu shi gu, bian luo ye su yi lu." Or, calligraphy practice without following the ancient method would degenerate to vulgar and wild ways. It tells us that in order to be refined, elegant, and cultivated in calligraphy, the traditional approach should be respected. So, don't you think that in martial art practice, the same principle should be followed? If you ask me about it, my answer will be a resounding yes. By the way, in martial art practice, if someone's practice was not authentic, in the old time, people would call it ye luzi or ridiculous approach. The opposite of this term is authentic and correct method or zheng luzi. To summarize, Wang Duo's key concept here is Shi Gu, which is applicable to many other Chinese arts and will be explained in the next topic. Second, Shi Gu and its standard. Now, let's talk about Shi Gu, the popular approach to Chinese art. Shi means imitate or study. Gu means ancient or tradition. Together, it means imitate the ancients or study the tradition. In general, people use the term Shi Gu to express an approach that one follows the ancient method in practice, as varied as art, morality, and even industrial production. Some other related terms which are the opposite of Shi Gu commonly include Shi Xin, follow your feelings, Shi Zao Hua, or following the nature. Overall, those terms have inner relationships and can be big topics in themselves, which I will talk about in the future. Now, let's talk about Shi Gu with respect to Chinese martial arts. In martial art practice, Shi Gu should be a key principle that everyone should respect and follow. But the main issue here is about the standard of the ancient principle. Without understanding important practice principles, the term Shi Gu would be meaningless. For example, many people claim to practice traditional Chinese martial arts, but if you look at their performance, it is not traditional at all. It is just random movements made to look fancy. Practicing at a temple on a mountain by wearing a strange religious robe will look convincing to beginners, but will not make the practice authentic at all. Now, the question here becomes, what is the standard of traditional practice? That brings the next topic. Topic 3. Chinese aesthetic standard of physical movement. Based on years of study, I noticed the major differences of aesthetic standard between Chinese and the Western approach in the expression of a physical movement. Basically, I believe that the fundamental aesthetic standard in Chinese practice is the pyramid shape approach, while the aesthetic standard in Western practice is more of an inverted pyramid shape approach. Let me explain. The ancient Chinese philosophy emphasized the benefit of being static rather than dynamic. Stability or stasis has been the major aesthetic approach for thousands of years. I'm using the term stasis here is to express a unique yin-yang theory concept that no entity is either fully static or full dynamic. In the case of the Chinese practice, the practitioner is static at the macro level, but dynamic in the micro level. We can notice this concept by observing not only traditional martial art practice, but also in other arts such as Chinese painting, ancient architecture, and even the way people posed for photographers back then. All of these examples demonstrated the static approach to aesthetics in the traditional Chinese practice. Just like Lao Tzu said, "Zhong wei qing gen, jing wei zao jun," which translates to "gravity is the root of lightness. Stillness is the ruler of movement." I have to say that this philosophical concept has dominated Chinese life for thousands of years. Of course, some schools of thought in China emphasize the importance of change, but still, change is rooted in status. I always say that the pyramid shape most accurately expresses the overall imagery of the ancient Chinese aesthetic standard. On the other hand, in my observation of aesthetics in Western practice, I noticed more of an inverted pyramid approach compared to the Chinese style. In my opinion, This is because the Western practice mainly focuses on dynamism, apart from a few common elements like symmetry and fluidity. An inverted pyramid seems to be the most suitable geometric representation for such an aesthetic approach. For example, if you look at ancient Greek statues or a bodybuilder displaying his physics or the stance of practitioners of Western boxing, you will often notice an inverted pyramid appearance. It's also possible that these differences is more noticeable to someone like myself who was born and raised in the East but now lives in the West. Of course, there are many static components in the Western arts as well. But in this case, I'm talking about the overall approach and the tendency of the most typical physical movement patterns in terms of body structure and dynamics. So, why should you care about these aesthetic differences? In my opinion, understanding the differences in aesthetics can really improve your practice of the traditional Chinese martial arts. Remember, any aesthetic standard is the result of a philosophy, culture, history, and of course, tradition. Only reaching the level of being able to conceptualize common phenomena would provide a much more profound impact on the understanding of a physical and tangible object. This is why I have explained this concept many times on different occasions to analyze the fundamental differences between the Chinese and the Western approaches in physical movements in order to help people improve their understanding of the traditional Chinese art. Now that we have looked at the general differences in aesthetic standards between Chinese and the Western style, what standards should we consider in the practice of internal martial arts? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 4. Ming and Qing Dynasty documents on martial theory. A lot of you may be familiar with important military documents such as Sun Zi or Art of War, Liu Tao, and many others. Unfortunately, those ancient documents were used for understanding and applying military strategy but had nothing to do with martial art training. Even though such military books are considered part of the Chinese wisdom in military administration, they do not provide much value in terms of individual martial training. So, were there any well-written martial training documents in Chinese history that are valuable today? Let's talk about this now. First, I have to introduce the last two Chinese dynasties, the Ming and the Qing dynasties. The Ming dynasty reigned from 1368 to 1644, while the Qing dynasty reigned from 1644 to 1912. A lot of historical research seems to suggest that most of the training documents in China were written during the middle period of the Ming dynasty. However, are all the training documents of that period equally important in guiding martial training? Of course not. Let me explain. Chinese martial training documents can be classified into two categories in terms of core content. The first category of documents focused on battle strategy and formations. The second category of documents focuses on individual training, which are very close to martial art training documents published in the late 300 years. The first category of documents were mainly used by royalty or military generals for training soldiers as a whole and has little to do with individual training. Of course, you may argue that military battle formation and strategies cannot be executed without individual soldiers. Well, in that case, feel free to read those documents and find out for yourself if they make any differences to your practice. The second category of training documents focuses on individual training. Like I mentioned in my prior video that Chinese martial arts were primarily developed on the battlefield. Documents for individual training came long after those used for collective training. I can confidently say that most of the high-quality training documents for individual practice were written towards the end of the Ming Dynasty, just over 400 years ago. I have briefly introduced some of these documents, including Quan Jing Quan Fa Bei Yao, Shou Bi Lu, Tai Ji Quan Theory, and others in prior video. Also, please keep in mind that some documents such as Jiu Yao Lun or Nine Important Discussions were actually written during this period of time, definitely not 1,000 years ago as claimed by many people. Later on, from the end of the Qing Dynasty until the 1940s, martial art practice largely shifted in focus from military training to individualized civilian training. This led to the publication of many high-quality martial art documents focusing on individual training. I consider this period to be the golden age of traditional Chinese martial arts. The theoretical foundation of traditional martial art practice should be based on these documents. So then, what is the practical references in terms of martial posture and body movements? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 5. Traditional references for martial postures and body movements. Merely understanding the theoretical foundation of traditional practice alone is not enough. You also need a good references to guide your martial posture. Theory without practical references most often leads to poor practice on account of misinterpretation. Unfortunately, Zhang Sanfeng did not invent the iPhone, or else we would have video footage of practitioners performing martial movements. Jokes apart, many great practitioners left behind many valuable photos. Since I teach the three internal styles, I'd like to talk about photos that should be used as references to guide your practice. Let me introduce them one by one. For Xing Yi, Xue Dian's photo can be the gold standard. We can observe and understand a lot of key principles of the style by carefully observing his photo, such as stability, weight distribution, body structure, and mental intention. Let me show you some other examples, such as Liu Dianchen, Zhang Zhaodong, Sun Lutang, Fu Jianqiu, Jin Yunting, For Tai Chi, Chen Fa Ke, Yang Chengfu, Wu Jianquan, and many others. Please pay close attention to Yang Chengfu's Tai Chi photo to understand Tai Chi principles such as Zhong Zheng or centralized structure, Peng Jin or word of power. Many people say that Yang Shengfu's Tai Chi is the big frame Tai Chi, and it is not as subtle as the small frame Tai Chi. Well, if you really believe it, that's your choice. However, I'm talking about the available photo reference. I believe that Yang Shengfu's Tai Chi photos are among the best. I think his photo is a solid reference for practitioners of any Tai Chi style, not just Yang style. To 八卦, unfortunately, there are not many photos as reference from that period. However, there are some of them, such as Cheng Youlong and Zhang Zhaodong. In the interest of time, I will not go into details for these photos. I can spend hours analyzing and explaining each photo based on specific martial standards. I will save that for future video. Now, I'd like to share a personal experience with you. When I studied martial arts, back then, I did not have a lot of opportunity to read some martial arts photos since we did not have the internet back then. However, I had a lot of opportunities to watch and observe many great demonstrations in person. What I did was to try my best to memorize their movement and try to recall their practice in my mind regularly. Later, I tried to imitate their movements during my own practice. I copied their body movements, speed, rhythm, energy feeling, and anything else I could remember. I highly recommend you follow this approach as well in your own practice. To summarize, I have introduced some important martial posture photos in this section. They are invaluable references for anyone who wants to follow the traditional way of practice, or Shi Gu. Please pay attention and revisit such references in the future. Now, let's move on to the next topic, in which I'd like to point out some common mistakes in applying this concept. Topic 6, common mistakes. This is a hard topic, since there are many common mistakes that have been happening in our community. Some of them are unintentional, such as some mistakes caused by a lack of instruction or lack of a systematic approach in training. It is an unfortunate situation, but I believe that with time, this situation will improve since more and more references are gradually becoming available. One important mistake I'd like to specifically point out is that some people in our community intentionally change the standard of the traditional practice. Their movement becomes so random and fancy that their practice almost becomes identical to modern wushu, but under some old names. Now, let me give you a couple of concrete examples. Let's consider Fa Jin and the movement involving Fa Jin. Effective execution of Fa Jin requires years of correct practice. It is impossible for anyone to perform it effectively without any prior training. However, in order to deny their inability to demonstrate it, some people in China claimed that Fa Jin practice did not exist at all in internal styles. This is not just wrong, but entirely dishonest and, in my opinion, an insult to the internal styles. Another ridiculous mistake is the understanding of Sung, or the state of relaxation in Tai Chi practice. Sung is an important traditional Tai Chi practice and standard. However, some people claim that Sung means simply letting all the muscle loose. They even claim that one of the key criteria to evaluate your level of the song is to check out how much muscle you have. You would be considered stiff if you have a lot of muscle. You would be considered as reaching a high level of song when you cannot lift any weight, let's say more than 50 pounds. If you would like to know more examples, I recommend you watch my video series on decoding martial proverbs. Again, if you practice martial art under the name of a traditional method, please respect the traditional standard as I mentioned earlier in this video. Do not just create random movements and make false claims, or it will become a loose or ridiculous approach. Topic 7. Demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate an exercise. This exercise is a famous one in the traditional martial art practice. Okay, today I'd like to share a traditional way of stretching. It will not only stretch the leg, but also practice the hip, the chest, neck, and the shoulder. The practice is very simple, okay? So you keep the feet apart, put the weight on the back leg. Now, make sure the back leg is straight. And then gradually bend the front knee, extend forward. Make sure, see the feet point forward, okay? Make sure the back knee gradually extend forward by maintaining the back leg straight. At the same time, if your right leg points forward, then your body turns to the right side. Okay? Turn to the right side. But we look toward the left shoulder. So become this kind of a posture. Make sure that knee points forward. Body turns to the right side. Look at the forward or left side through the left shoulder. Make sure the back leg is straight. Then head extend upward. Then turn to the other side and follow the same principle. By doing so, your body become flexible and it will become the natural flexibility. Natural flexibility will stay with you in the future. Topic 8. Takeaways. This is the short video, but a lot of interesting topics have been covered. First, Wang Duo's calligraphy is considered one of the highest levels in terms of its artistic achievement. More importantly, his quotation can be applied in martial art practice. It is, Shu Bu Shi Gu, Bian Luo Ye Su Yi Lu. Practicing calligraphy without following ancient method, then it would degenerate to be vulgar and wild way. A great expression to emphasize the importance of the traditional approach. Second, Shi Gu, or the concept of study and respect for tradition, is briefly introduced. Third, aesthetic standard of the Chinese physical movement, which is the pyramid shape approach, compared to the inverted pyramid shape approach used mainly in the West, has been discussed. Fourth, most of the high-quality martial training documents were written during the Ming and the Qing dynasties. Fifth, photographs of martial postures from the late Qing dynasty to the Republic of China period are some of the best references. Sixth, common mistakes such as using random movements to replace the traditional practice is a serious issue in our community, which should be avoided. That's the end of today's video. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.